Josiah Willard Gibbs was a man of reticence and shrewdness. He was regarded by Einstein as the greatest mind in American history, and by Max Planck as one of the greatest theoretical physicists to ever live. Now, regardless of how exaggerated or biased those statements may be, we'll get a glimpse, in this video, of who he really was, and what it is he's so well known for. It's worth noting that this video is essentially a summary of the book Josiah Willard Gibbs, The History of a Great Mind, by Lyne P. Wheeler, originally published in 1951 by Yale University Press. Gibbs was born on February 11, 1839, in New Haven, Connecticut, to Marianna Van Cleve and Josiah Willard Gibbs. His father, being of the same name, was referred to as Josiah, while he, the junior, was referred to as Willard. In predicting Willard's future intellectual prowess, were offered his mother's ancestry, which has a history of scholarship, and his father Josiah, who was actually a professor at Yale College, specializing in theology and linguistics. Gibbs attended the Hopkins Grammar School in New Haven, and there seemed to exhibit the same character traits that so marked him later on in life. Reticence, studiousness, overall intelligence, etc. After graduating from the grammar school, he went on to Yale College. Now, there's a story that tells how Gibbs got into Yale, but its validity is questionable. Supposedly, he was so nervous about the entrance examinations and whether or not he was prepared for them that he decided to go to a faculty member there at Yale to get a better idea of what he needed to know to get in. After a series of questions, the faculty member decided Gibbs was a qualified candidate and admitted him into the university right there on the spot. What's weird about that story is that his father is said to have gotten into Yale the same way. At Yale, he excelled. Every year he took home a top prize for his Latin composition, or his solution to a mathematical problem, or both. After graduating from Yale, on account of his own interests and the academic climate in the United States at the time, he became a graduate student of engineering in the Department of Philosophy and the Arts at Yale in the fall of 1858. Crucial to this period of his life is that, by the time he had defended his doctoral thesis, both of his parents had died. On top of that, Gibbs had a suspicion that he was quite susceptible to tuberculosis. It's therefore not unreasonable to believe that the family responsibilities he inherited from the loss of his parents, coupled with his uncertainty of health, were the main factors of his lifelong bachelorhood. After obtaining his doctorate in engineering in 1863, Gibbs received a somewhat customary 3-year position as a tutor there at Yale. Nothing terribly important happened during these 3 years of his life. He mostly taught Latin and worked primarily on mechanical inventions that never actually made it big. The picture you see now is of him during his tutor years. Upon termination of his tutoring tenure at Yale, he went on a 3-year European sojourn. Aside from living it up in the European cultural hotspots, he studied mathematics and physics quite intensely. In contrast with his previous interest in America, he focused on theoretical topics here, attending lectures from leading academic figures at the time, such as Liouville, Weierstrass, and Kronecker. By reading his notes from this period, we learn that, despite being amidst intellectual giants of the time, he drew little inspiration from the academics of his age. In fact, he drew inspiration from no one source in particular, no single intellectual figure, but from the myriad of historical figures he deemed appreciable. Gibbs returned to America from his European sojourn in the summer of 1869, taught French for 2 years, and in 1871 was appointed professor of mathematical physics at Yale College, the first position of its kind in the United States, by the way. His first domain of interest was thermodynamics, and the culmination of his thoughts on the topic became the landmark paper called On the Equilibrium of Heterogeneous Substances, which he published in 2 parts from 1875 to 1878. His primary contributions to the field were twofold. First, he introduced the concept of the chemical potential, which plays the role of an additional thermodynamic quantity, on top of temperature and pressure, that characterizes the contribution of a given substance to a potentially heterogeneous mixture of substances, which at the time was a seemingly intractable problem. With this notion, he modified the prime equation of thermodynamics as per the picture shown. Through this modified equation of thermodynamics, chemical equilibrium is expressed as an equality of all the chemical potentials comprising the mixture. This can actually be given a geometric interpretation, in which the equilibrium condition between two or more substances is cast into the problem of finding the intersections of various level surfaces. The great physicist Maxwell actually appreciated this concept so much that he made a clay model of the thermodynamic surface representing the equilibrium conditions for the different phases of water. Using this clay mold, he cast three plaster models, one of which he later presented to Gibbs in person. And by the way, Maxwell's personal copy is currently on permanent display at the Cavendish Laboratory in Cambridge University. And Gibbs's copy is currently on permanent exhibition at the Sloan Physics Laboratory in New Haven. His second contribution was the concept of available energy, or, in modern terms, Gibbs free energy. Remember that modified equation from thermodynamics from earlier? Yeah, that's what's called the Gibbs potential. Simply put, the Gibbs potential is minimized in chemical equilibrium when the temperature and pressure are held fixed. Similarly, the change in the Gibbs potential, or the Gibbs free energy, is the maximum amount of work that a thermodynamic system can do when, as before, the temperature and pressure are held fixed. These concepts helped solve the long-standing problem in chemistry of what condition necessitated a chemical reaction to occur. Another domain of his interest was mathematics. At the time, Hamilton's quaternions were the preferred tool for working with Maxwell's equations of electricity and magnetism, but they were complicated and cluttered. Gibbs sought to replace them with something simpler, and thus was the birth of vectors and vector analysis, which are now as common as an old shoe. Oliver Heaviside from England also developed vectors around the same time, but their efforts were completely independent of each other. Gibbs also saw that his vector analysis, while constructing it, was merely a specific case of Hermann Grassmann's exterior algebra, which had been developed decades before but was totally ignored. Inspired by this earlier work, Gibbs sought to publicize Grassmann's exterior algebra and establish its priority. Probably the most lasting impact Gibbs has made on theoretical physics is his formulation of statistical mechanics, a term that he actually coined. In 1902, the culmination of nearly two decades of deep intellectual sifting and sorting finally arrived in the form of a 200-page paper titled Elementary Principles of Statistical Mechanics. This paper put all the existing knowledge on the subject at the time into a cogent framework that, since its publication, has remained almost entirely intact, a statement that can be made for only a finger few theoretical discoveries in the history of mankind. To make a long story short, his work showed that one can arrive at conventional thermodynamics by allowing for uncertainty in a classical system with a sufficiently enormous number of degrees of freedom. He defined notions such as extension in phase, which we now call phase-based volume, and density in phase, which we now call phase-based density, or, in the modern quantum mechanical version, the statistical matrix. What made his framework so powerful was that it made the least assumptions of the nature of the mechanical system. It made no assumption of any molecular structure, and made bare assumptions of the underlying mechanics. This made it possible to accommodate the laws of quantum mechanics that weren't established until nearly two decades later. As time went by, Gibbs's personality kindly waned. Towards his later years, he was almost entirely concerned with his personal work and markedly unconcerned with matters such as politics or the promotion of his own reputation. One possible downfall of this is that he never really took on any students, and so the dissemination of his work into the younger generation took quite some time. He never lost his warm and courteous personality, though, according to those who knew him. On April 28, 1903, at 64 years of age, Gibbs died of acute intestinal obstruction. I think what's clear about Gibbs, especially for all who study his work, is that he was able to see further than the average human, and not just in physics. He seems to have had the ability to transcend the trivialities of man and the cognitive abilities of his contemporaries. I'll conclude this video with what I believe to be a particularly insightful excerpt from Gibbs' letter of acceptance of the Rumford Medal in 1881. One of the principal objects of theoretical research in any department of knowledge is to find the point of view from which the subject appears in its greatest simplicity. The success of the investigations, in this respect, is a matter on which he who makes them may be least able to form a correct judgment. It is, therefore, an especial satisfaction to find one's methods approved by competent judges.